अस्सलामु अलैकुम, वेलकम टू लेक्चर नंबर 28 फॉर द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ सॉफ्टवेयर डिज़ाइन एंड आर्किटेक्चर, आईटेक 4129। आई एम योर कोर्स इंस्ट्रक्टर फाहद अनवार। सो स्टूडेंट्स, बिफोर आई स्टार्ट माई टूडेज लेक्चर डिस्कशन, आई वुड लाइक टू गिव यू अ लिटल बिट रीकेप अबाउट ओवर लास्ट लेक्चर। सो स्टूडेंट्स, वट वी डिस्कस्ड इन ओवर लास्ट लेक्चर, वी सी how to document a software architecture, where we see the practitioner community perspective towards how we can document our software architecture, and we see different approaches towards documenting any software architecture. We discuss five approaches for to document any software architecture. We see a 4+1 view model, which tells us how to ensure architectural level documentation, and then we see a Sonis view, rational unified process, and then we see IEEE 1471 standard and the Bayes approach, and then after these approaches we also discuss who use the architectural documentation or who are the actual stakeholder for our architectural documentation, and we also see different roles of who utilizes this architectural documentation, where we see the role of analyst, architect, business manager, customer, deployer, designer, implementer, integrator as well. So we see we see these different roles along with their descriptions and uses of the architectural documentation as well. After the uses of architectural documentation, we see seven rules for sound documentation. These seven rules provides us a pillar for any sound documentation. For these seven rule was, number one was the right documentation from the reader's point of view. Number two, avoid unnecessary repetition. Number three, avoid ambiguity. And number four, use a standard organization. Number five, record the rational. And number six was keep documentation current, but not too current or too simple. And the number seven, or the last rule for sound documentation, was review documentation for fitness for purpose. So students, and then we see these software architecture documents provides a comprehensive overview, architectural overview for any system, like using a number of different architectural views to depict different aspects of the system as well. And then after these seven rules for sound documentation, we also see why do we need software architecture. We see knowledge sharing, communication, and analysis type characteristics or attributes are actually provided by the software architectural documentation. And then we also see some tips for writing any good architectural documentation, like avoid repetitions, recognize for whom you are writing, avoid ambiguities, maintain relevance, and review your documentation as well. And then at the last of our previous lecture, students, I also tell you about some popular tools for creating software architecture, where we see Microsoft Visual, Enterprise Architect, Draw.io, and then OmniGraphle as well. So students, these are the different popular tools which are actually utilized for creating any software architecture. So students, it was a little bit recap about our last week lectures or topics about documenting how to document any software architecture from practitioners community perspective. And now students, we are moving towards another approach. So students, let's formally start our today's lecture discussion. Students, the objective of our today's lecture discussion to discuss the reusability approach. Now students, we are actually moving towards the end of our this course. In this lecture we will study about the software product line, which is a reusability approach. In the next week we will cover about aspect oriented architecture, which is another reusability approach. And in the last of our over this course, we will discuss about the model driven architecture, which is also another reusability approach. Now students, in the next 3 or 4 weeks we will cover the reusability based software architectures. And now in this lecture and in the coming 2 lectures or in this week, students, we will cover the software product line, which is actually a reusability approach of any software design. So here is a brief objective of our today's lecture discussion. We will discuss about what is a software product line, and we see a motivation for this product line as well, and we also discuss a meta model for software product line, and we will see the reasoning about this product line as well, and we see the software product line engineering notion as well, and we also see the main difference between the domain and the product line as well. And at the end of this lecture, we will see return on investment of software product line as well. So students, let's formally start the discussion of our today's lecture. So first of all, before I start my today's lecture discussion, so students, one thing you must note about this software product line. So students, you must note that software product line is basically a reusability approach. We also utilize different reusable components, architectures, tools, techniques in our daily life. So this software product line is actually a reusability approach. So let's start about this reusability approach, software product line. So software product line, students, actually you can say that is an application type which is generalized around a common architecture, so that we can adopt it, this common architecture for different purposes in, around our environment in real life as well. So students, you can say that any organization that has many software system will notice that many of those software systems have some characteristics in common. So when a set of system has common attributes or characteristics, so they are candidates to become part of product family or a product line. So we can say that a product line has set of some core assets upon which a shared family or system is actually built as well. So a product line basically consists of a multiple system which basically have same architecture and share common core assets. These core assets actually include like shared components, interfaces, tools, processes, documentation, and shared architecture as well, and the variability among systems as well. So what is the students, what is the main theme behind utilizing this product line approach, or the motivation for this, you can say the main motivation for this approach? Like students, in our if you see around around your daily life, like complexity, size, and number of software based systems are a major problem for big IT industry or even the for the government sector as well. So by utilizing the routine functionality is custom written from scratch again and again and over and over around our daily life. So these ambiguities and these ambiguities and interoperability conflicts not only across different companies but even among groups within the same company as well. So student, this product line approach actually provide us the reduction of cost, improve delivery time of the product, so ultimately the productivity of our software product will be enhanced, and obviously when you will utilize the any reusability approach which will be refined again and again with respect to time, so you can conclude, you can say that the quality will also be improved as well. So this product line is actually a family of products which we designed to take the maximum benefit of their common aspects and their predicted variability as well. So this is a little bit introduction about the reusability approach named as software product line. So you should also know that every company or every software house also built their own software product line. So if one company have their own product line, so it is not a necessary another company will also have a same software product line. Every company has their own repository or a shared software product line, and every company has their own core assets or values. So software product line will be vary from one company to another company. What is the motivation behind to build this software product line? So students, like complexity, size, the number of lines or number of codes or a number of functions points involving in the softwares are a major problem for software companies, and the developer need to write down the routine functions or the same functions again and again repeatedly from scratch over and over. So this requires a lot of time, or there is a dilemma of data formats and applications as well. So Quagmire is basically a dilemma about data formats and applications to write the same routine functions or a same line of code again and again by our valuable developers from the scratch. So it also consumes their times, their quality, their cost as well. So so ambiguities and interoperability actually conflicts about across different companies, but even conflict can be exist among group within the same company as well. So that's why we repetition of routine functions over and over from scratch. So that's why to save our time, quality and cost, and to also enhance the productivity of any software product, the most of the companies trying to move towards the software product line, which is basically a reusability approach. So that is the main motivation of software product line by different companies in the IT sector. So this is a meta model of software product line. So students, if you look into this diagram, basically there are some core. Before we start this diagram, students, like we can say that many organizations which actually develop software, they create multiple software applications like that have some characteristics in common. Like we can say some software has the same application architecture and some run on the same execution platform as well. So what are the commonalities are among us the software application? So students, it is important that these commonality must be managed properly. So any organization can realize the highest economy of sale. So that's why the product line practice was designed to manage software products and their commonalities, which were designed to maximize the benefits of any organization. So students, any product must be appropriate to their respective business goals and application domain as well, which must be satisfied by any shared architecture of a product. So and these products are also built from the already built base architectural, which ultimately built different component and services, and these different business goals and application which is satisfied by any shared architecture, and these shared architecture ultimately used to build component and services which actually forms a product. So business goals, application domain, architecture, component and services, these three different dimensions of any product are basically a core asset of any organization. So this product line is these three things actually form a baseline product line. So it is not necessary a baseline product line will only contain these three concepts. So their core assets will also be include some other things as well, like core assets basically are reusable, which can be used by different perspectives, like component, framework, different libraries, like different tools, like different development or execution platforms as well. So students, why this my question to you is, so students, why this software product line is important for any organization? So like every organization builds product that have some aspects in common. So so why we need to develop it again and again from scratch? So we should look towards some reusability approach, so that we can decrease over time, so that the productivity will be enhanced, our budget will also be reduced as well, and we with the help of this reusability approach, we can also get a better quality product as well. So these are the different reasons which are actually provide a main motivation for different companies to shift themselves towards this software product line based approach as well. So students, any product must be appropriate to their business goal and share an architecture which must be satisfied by, or the different products are actually built from their different components and services, which actually leading us towards the product line. So students, these are the different core assets of any product line. So you will also get more core assets and some fame hall of the product line will be discussed in our later slides as well. So these are the three main aspects of software product line: the appropriate business goal, shared architecture for any product, and the component and services of the product. So these are three are the basically students these three are provides the main theme for any product. So what is the reasoning behind the software product line approach? So like student, as I discussed earlier, any organization like you can say which develop or create multiple software, so all of these will have some characteristics in terms of tools, applications, requirements, architecture and other characteristics in common. So some software also has the same application architecture, so some run on the same execution platform and others support the same segment of the business. So we can say that what are the commonalities are among the software application. So it is very important that these kind of commonalities in execution platforms, business segments, architecture level, requirement level, domain level. So these type of commonalities must be managed properly so that organization can realize the highest economy of scale by utilizing this reusability approach, which we called a software product line. So this reusability approach of software product line helps any organization to not develop all of the functionalities, components from scratch, so that they can utilize their software product line, so that their products they can enhance their productivity and develop a product on time with the required quality, and they can also deliver a economy friendly device or product as well. So what is software product line engineering? So students, what is software product line engineering? So students, before I start the software product line engineering, so software product line is basically one of the field of software engineering, and software engineering actually emerged in the late 60s, and this software product line engineering is basically a reusability approach, which actually is a software engineering paradigm which helps the organization towards the development of products from their core assets. What are the core assets? As I discussed earlier, so core assets for any organization can be their component, their shared architecture, framework, different tools, different development or execution platform. So these are the different core assets for any organization as well. So this product line engineering guides different organization for the development of their products from their core assets instead of looking towards develop these products from scratch. So the notion behind this product line engineering is to develop different products from their core assets rather than developing the product from scratch. So that's the main notion behind this software product line engineering, is not to build from scratch. You should utilize the reusability approach, which we named as product line, which actually based on their core assets. So these are the two different terms behind product line engineering. So number one, these are the two different models of product line engineering. You can say the number one is modeling, and then which is also we call it technology, and the number second is development. So what is a modeling, students? Modeling is basically is a design for reuse. So it also refers to original design. So in this modeling technique, which is basically a domain knowledge, so in this domain knowledge we actually built our software designed for the purpose of reuse of our appropriate community. We built our software with this intention. This software or component will be reused with some other community as well. So this is a concept of design for reuse. You build your design only for the purpose for reusability with other community, with other people around or surround you. And the second part is that development, which is basically an application engineering, which we also call a design with reuse. So whatever, so students, whenever the new requirements will come or will whenever the new requirements will exist in the emerging environment, so we need to develop a new system. So we actually utilize that design with reuse. So whatever the design was built by the domain knowledge, which we call a design for reuse, now this design will be reused to implement these new requirements. We will not go to build this from scratch. Now we will utilize the different designs which are already built from the modeling perspective. So now here, this design with reuse actually refers to routine practice or the use of known solutions already existing in the market as well. So whenever the new requirement will be emergent in real world environment, so design with reuse approach is also a very popular approach in product line engineering. So with the help of routine practices, we will reuse this design as well. We will build our design with reusability, which already have been built in the domain knowledge. So ultimately we will get a product in a timely, in a short time, economy friendly product, and with the enhanced quality as well. So students, domain knowledge is actually about the technology which actually we are looking for the design for the purpose of reuse. And the development is actually an application engineering where the actual product is built whenever a new requirement is emergent. We utilize the already known solutions or which we call a design with reuse approach as well. So it is, these are the two different terms of domain knowledge, and these are two different models in product line engineering. The number one is modeling and the number second is development. Modeling we also call a design for reuse, and the number two is development, which we call a design with reuse. So once again I am repeating, design for reuse mean you design your product, your component, software, whatever, only for the sake of reuse purpose by another community. That's all. So whenever the new requirement will come, so whatever the design you build for the sake of reuse in the domain knowledge. And now in the development part, which is basically an application engineering area, so here you will design new require, build this new requirement with the help of design with reusability approach, which already have been built in the domain knowledge as well. So in the development part, we are actually looking for the already known solutions, which we call a design with reuse, which actually provide us a deliver us a very time to market product as well. So what are the difference between the domains versus the product line? So students, these are the two pretty straightforward terms. So here I put some examples so that you can get better idea about these two terms. So student, basically domain is a problem space where the actual problem exists. So for that problem, actually we built a new models, like as we see in the earlier in the modeling part of product line engineering, we actually do a domain engineering where we develop a different designs for reuse for different type of problems, as we see in the design patterns as well, where we provide a common solution to a common problem. And product line are basically a solution space. So any different companies have their own product line. So whatever the their problems, they will from their product line, they will try to dug out their appropriate or respective solution from their product lines as well. So what can be the domains? Like I put here different examples, like consumer electronics is a domain, avionics is a domain, compiler is a domain, video game is a domain. So I also write a different product line against each domain. So consumer electronic can have a domain or a product line of Philips digital TVs. It is a product line, and avionics have a Boeing 747 family. Where they utilize more of the 60% of the components in different Boeing planes as well. And similarly, other are also have the different product lines. And in the next lecture, we will also discuss some state of the art companies who actually utilizes the different product lines, and they are up to the mark companies in the world. So now students, this is till here what we discuss. It's a little bit literature view, you can say that, you can introduction or a baseline information about what is actually software product line. Now we are moving towards the some definitions of software product line. So here we can define, so here this definition is actually provided by Software Engineering Institute SEI in 2002, which actually defines the software product line as a software intensive system which sharing a common managed set of features which satisfy the specific put your focus here, not the general needs, it's a specific needs of particular market segment or their mission, and that are developed from a common set of core assets in a prescribed way. We also discuss the core assets. So there are different core assets for different companies, like component, structure, function, framework, library, tool, development or execution platform. These are the different core assets for the company. So this is a formal definition provided by the Software Engineering Institute in 2002. So the term of this software product line is also introduced in the later 2000 era as well. So this software product line is basically a family of product designed to take the benefit of their common aspects and their predicted variability as well. So this is also one of the definition of product line. So this product line actually designed to manage software products and their commonalities, which are designed to maximize the benefits of the organization. So so you can get better idea about these terms, because software product line is a reusability approach which helps the companies to maximize their benefits in terms of time, in terms of quality, and obviously in terms of budget as well. So in short time, they can increase their productivity with the help of their baseline software product lines as well. So students, here is a return on investment of software product line. So students, as the field of software engineering emerges in the late 50s or 60s, when software engineering was considered as a hardware engineering in the 60s, when the top scientists and researchers combines together the first time in the NATO conference, the first time the term of software engineering was introduced, where they agree on some common point. There also exists a separate field from a hardware which they called a software engineering. And now from latest 1960s, the field of software engineering emerges, from where they started to build different theoretical foundations, different models, different techniques, tools for this software engineering subject as well. And in the 60s, they actually discover the subroutines, and then in the 70s which also considered the era of Barry Boehm, and they introduces a modules concept. And then in the 90s, we moving towards the object oriented paradigms. And then in the late 90s, we moving towards the components and different services oriented component as well. And now in the later 2000, we also introduced some services as well. And now after the 2002 era, we actually moving towards the software product line. So this is basically the hard time when the software engineering field was introduced. And you can see that in the 60s, 70s, 80s, up to 2000, subroutines, modules, objects, components, and services were built. When the scientists put a lot of their efforts, most of the research was carried out in this field, so that they can get the different theoretical foundations of this subject as well. And now after the 2002, they actually built a software product line from the already invested areas, and from these subroutines, modules, objects, components, services, they actually form a software product line, which is actually a return on investment of their field, which the community of software engineering have invested from 1960s to 2000. And now from onwards to 2000, the return on investment was actually capturing by different companies with one of the reusability approach, which we call a software product line. So basically, this return on investment is basically a performance measure which we use to evaluate the efficiency of an investment, or compare the efficiency of a number of different investments in the future. So what are the different investments we made in the software engineering field? So these subroutines, modules, objects, component and services. Students, these are the different investments which are made by different software engineering professionals, institutes in this field from 1960s to 2000. So these are the different investments which are actually made by the researchers and the software engineering community to evolve this field as well. And now after the proper discovery of this software product line, which is a reusability approach from the software engineering institute, so this is the point where from these different investments we get the software product line in the shape of return on investment, which we actually made in our past, like in the 60s, 70s, we build subroutines, modules, objects, components and services. These are our investment which we did in the software engineering field. And now after the 2002 era, we get different reusability in the specific 2002 or the later 2000, we get the different reusability approaches. So these different reusability approaches are basically providing a return on investment for the software engineering institute or a software engineering community as well. So students, till here our lecture number 28 about the introduction of what are actually the software product lines, from where they emerge, so what is the foundation behind this software product line, and what is the formal definition, some examples, their meta model have been discussed in this lecture very comprehensively. So students, in next lecture we will carry out the some other perspective of the software product line as well. So students, till here our lecture number 28 is ended.